our presenter this evening. Melissa, as I said, is known to all of you, I'm sure. If you've had any contact with the museum, you know how important Melissa is. You know that when you go in, you're going to be answered, you're going to be looked after, you're going to be cared for, and I have a great time when I go in because we share some very interesting stories. She'll tell you about them sometime if you're all interested. Melissa?
What's in my jar, and I won't reveal it, but if it was something that was not water, it would be very appropriate for the Collingwood of 1867 that we're going to be talking about this evening. Okay, so thank you everyone for having me here tonight. It's an honor, and it's certainly very interesting to be able to focus on a specific year in Collingwood's history. Quite unique, and also posed quite a few challenges because upon going to the Collingwood Library and looking through the museum's collection, there isn't a single newspaper from Collingwood from 1867. So basically what the staff at the museum, which two staff members are here in addition to myself, Tyler Clearly and Lindsay Cook, they were instrumental in researching and finding photographs for this presentation this evening, as well as Jackie Plater, who couldn't be here. But in our research, we consulted quite heavily the Directory of Collingwood from 1866 to 67, the Jubilee History of Collingwood from 1887, and also the Huron Institute Papers and Records, of which there are three volumes, and those, of course, were compiled, I don't need to be speaking into this, they were compiled by the secretary and later largely curator of the Huron Institute, David Williams. And the Huron Institute predated the Collingwood Museum, and when we were established in the 60s, we assumed that early collection. Now, in thinking about Collingwood's history, there are many things that we immediately think about. Many people think of the shipyard, for example, or Smart's Cannery, where many families worked at one time. For others, the railway and the grain terminals loom large. All of these things, some of which existed in 1867, but some of those that didn't, and many of the things that we think of as defining our town hadn't yet come to be, and those people hadn't arrived yet. So let us look at what 1867 was and what basically led to the existence of the town at that time. And please keep in mind that this presentation is a sampling only of life in Collingwood in 1867. The staff at the museum will be working on an exhibit to celebrate Confederation, and we'll be getting into these details in quite a bit more detail. However, the content of tonight's presentation was largely based on the museum's collection and what it would bring to this. Now, the earliest depictions of what would be come the town of Collingwood exists largely in part to the town's earliest surveyors and landowners. And here we have an early map of Collingwood from 1854. And the surveyor's name there, if you can read it, is William Gibbard. And he was very active. Indeed, if you look at the early newspaper articles from Collingwood's history, his advertisements are quite prevalent. Also, in addition to seeing some of the early streets names, which are named after the property owners at the top there, you can read them, the McMaster, Patterson, Hamilton, and Robinson, all street names that exist today. Again, going back to 1854, we see an early engraving of what Collingwood Harbor looked like. Very different from today, very much a swampy, largely undesirable area that people passed through only. So what was it that brought people here? And indeed, it was the prospect of the Ontario, Huron, and Simcoe Railway building the northern terminus of the railway here. In 1854, Collingwood Harbor had already been selected as the northern terminus of the Ontario, Huron, and Simcoe Railway by railway officials who had visited the site a year earlier and christened the area Collingwood. after the township directly to the west. Sir Sanford Fleming, a very young Sir Sanford Fleming, was among them. And members of the party also included landowner named B.W. Smith, and he was indeed the county sheriff. And at one point in Collingwood's history, he owned over 300 acres of town, of property within the town. And not surprisingly, he was very instrumental in bringing the railway to Collingwood, which made him a very wealthy man, actually. The railway promised great opportunities to those looking to settle in this area. And according to longtime resident John Nettleton, boats from Chicago had been running here from the opening of the railway in 1855, and immigration to the western states came through Collingwood to Chicago. The boats were withdrawn for 2 years between 1857 and 59, but they then commenced to run again. The reciprocity treaty made by Lord Elgin was in force at this time, but abrogated after the Civil War when the boats were again withdrawn. During these early years, the boats brought mess pork and other goods to be shipped to Canada and the eastern states, and returned loaded with rail ties and telegraph poles. During this time, our town did a good business with the steamboat hands. From this, we expected great results, as we were on the direct route with our railway in the Great Northwest. But we were again disappointed. Then another period of stagnation commenced and continued more or less until the Confederation of the Provinces in 1867. I remember a part of the speech of the mayor, George Watson, after, this is John Nettleton saying this, after he had raised the flag at the celebration, that the key of the Great Northwest was in our hands, that we would unlock the treasures. And that's quoted from the Huron Institute Papers and Records, Mr. John Nettleton in 1914. With the completion of the railway to Collingwood in 1855, the Swampy Settlement was immediately connected to Collingwood and the Upper Lakes. In fact, the only other railway operational at this time in what would become the Dominion of Canada was an 11-mile stretch between Lachine and Montreal. The advantage awarded to our early settlement was certainly without match and assists in explaining how the Swampy scene of 1854 became an amalgamated town within 4 short years. The erection of the railway terminus on Huron Street, which we see here, greatly influenced the establishment and positioning of Collingwood's first businesses, particularly hotels and taverns. Here we see the first station alongside the railway hotel, or Riley House, depicted here as Weeks House and later the Armstrong House. The hotels changed names a lot in this period of time, and it's quite difficult to actually track them down. There's quite a few people in Collingwood who are trying to do just that and have been doing that for 2 years now. Further east, so the building to the furthest on your left there, that's actually the corner of Minnesota and Rodney Streets, and this hotel was known as the Malakoff and was said to have been built by an early settler named Collingwood Harris, the most convenient name. The railway hotel burned, as many buildings did, in 1881. And was allegedly done so by workers on their way to build the CPR tracks. And as I noted, as the tracks into Collingwood were being laid, British North America, which included the United Province of Canada, New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, PEI, and the Newfoundland colony, were engaged in a treaty with the US called the Canadian-American Reciprocity Treaty, that allowed for the free trade of raw materials between 1854 and 1866. One of the reasons for its demise in 66, right before Confederation, was due to the British's alleged collaboration with the Confederate States of America during the Civil War. Remember this, as this will arise in our discussion of Collingwood's military involvement in the Fenian raids. And this is just another perspective of that station. There were three functioning tunnels, and by functioning I mean through tunnels that the tracks went through, and the others were decoration. And indeed, there was a waiting room on the one side, and the freight sheds would actually be built in just a little bit, and I have a picture of that. The 1886-67 Directory of Collingwood contains many interesting advertisements, one of which was for the Northern Railway of Canada and the railway hotel that we saw a picture of. And I am going to go into some of the detail here about what's depicted. It goes through the directors of the railway, but more interesting is the bottom line on the left. It references steamer Clifton and a stage daily to Thornbury, Meaford, Cape Rich, and Owen Sound. This was before the North Gray Line would have been constructed in the 1870s. So stage and steamer really were the quickest ways to get to these communities. Now we're getting closer to 1867. Again, it's hard to pinpoint exact pictures from this year. This was taken in 1862 and captures improvements or the construction being made of the Collingwood rail yards. In the foreground, we see the construction of the freight house. Indeed, workers are on the roof. While in the background, we see a very unique and less grandiose view of the 1855 tunnel station. From this view, we can see that there are three wooden tunnels, as I pointed out, of the eight in the previous slide. Further still, the Northern Railways and Collingwood's first of three grain elevators is visible as the northernmost structure. Since the completion of the railway into Collingwood, the Ontario, Huron, and Simcoe Railway has already given way to the Northern Railway, soon to become the Grand Trunk and much later the Canadian National. And again, I must credit the Huron Institute for these wonderful photographs that we have. I've said this numerous times throughout my presentations, but whenever you see a number written in the top corner of a photograph, that was done by David Williams. And for each number, there's a corresponding description, which for the staff at the museum and researchers in Collingwood is invaluable in learning the history of Collingwood. And on our next slide, not the same corner. Consistency doesn't matter so much. It's just the fact that it's there. Now this is the elevator that we can see in the northern point of the last slide. And this photograph again was taken in 1862. In 1855, the Louisiana, the pioneer steamer of the Chicago Line, arrived at Collingwood. The line consisted at first of four large side wheel steamers. Afterwards, a line of propellers was established. But for 3 or 4 years past, the company had ceased to subsidize or employ steamers at a loss. And the communication with Chicago has been mainly kept up by large schooners, some come down with cereals and take back timber. Now this description of trade in this era really does hit on that treaty and the trade agreement between the United States and early Canada. And the steamer was quite active in transporting passengers as much as raw materials to various points along the lakes. And as some of you will know, Collingwood's early nickname was the Chicago of the North. Didn't quite live up to it. I also read we were the Buffalo of the North too, which Chicago sounds a little bit nicer, I think. This is a little bit of an indulgence slide. It's one of my favorites. And it's the same structure that we're looking at again. It's just much earlier. From the Huron Institute records, I believe this photograph was taken in 1856 or 57. And the vessel there is called the Whales, with its captain, Ben Tripp. This elevator would be replaced in 1870 to 71 by the second Grand Trunk elevator. So you see, this was a building that was very specific to the period that we are speaking about tonight. In 1866, Collingwood was well connected to local and distant ports. One could travel daily by the steamer Clifton, as I mentioned, to Thornbury, Meaford, Cape Richenoe Sound. Also, by the steamer Algoma, pictured in the previous slide, to Sault Ste. Marie, Lake Superior, and intermediate ports on the 1st, 11th, and 21st of every month. And you could travel by the steamer Wabanaw for Sault Ste. Marie and intermediate ports every Wednesday morning. The Algoma will connect at Sault Ste. Marie every week. That's from the directory, but when I was copying it, it was getting rid of some of my letters. But this photograph is of the Wabanaw, and as many of you will know, the Wabanaw was a very mysterious shipwreck. And we currently have a photograph, or a depiction of the wreck of the Wabanaw by local artist Ernie Taylor on display at the Collingwood Museum. But that was a ship that was frequenting Collingwood's harbors quite consistently in the era that we're discussing this evening. This is one of my favorite advertisements that we came across at the museum. Not only is it an advertisement, but it contains a map. I don't know how accurate it is. We were trying to identify some of the buildings, and we were successful in some of them. Now, of most importance in this is, my glasses on. See if I can make this work. Okay, there. So up here, we see the Northern Railway Depot. And until we came across this, we read descriptions about where the station was located, but we didn't quite, we couldn't see it. It wasn't on any map that we had. So this was really the first visual. We could see the photographs, of course, but photographs, it's often hard to place them exactly when you're using buildings that exist currently. And by trying to look in the background to see what's depicted, it's often difficult. All that to say, this was a very exciting find. Now, Lindsay's store is here, and Mr. James Lindsay was quite an important and early businessman in Collingwood. He was connected with the Masonic Lodge, as we'll see, as were many of the early residents of Collingwood. And the gentleman here, whose only two names on this map are Lindsay and Cameron here. And the Cameron Hotel is actually the North American Hotel. And we have quite a number of photographs in the collection that depict this early hotel that I'll show you. Also, a building that, there's two buildings here that we know exist, or one building that exists today, and that is this building here. That is the current Shipyards Medical Center, which was the Queen's Hotel previously, which was originally built by a gentleman named John McMaster. And he built it and owned it for a number of years and then relocated to Toronto. Another building of importance here is this building right here. And this was the first, the Globe Hotel in its original form. And the Globe Hotel became the Mountain View. And I'm sure many of you have stories from the Mountain View. And that building was sadly taken down more than a few years ago now, maybe almost four, which is sad. But they were very early staples in Collingwood's commercial history. Now, keep in mind this building. We're going to go to a picture that will show you what this streetscape here looked like in the 1860s. So that building on the left is the Shipyards Medical Center. And today, if you were looking at this using the same vantage point, you would see the beautiful Shipyards mural that's on that building. And further still, of course, you see the line of the escarpment, which tonight would be lit up beautifully with the ski lights. But of course, skiing didn't come for many decades later. And to our knowledge, that is the only existing building that remains in that photograph. All of the buildings were frame, and of course, very susceptible to fire. I don't know of a fire that took out Huron Street, but certainly, and something that Bruce mentioned in a later topic this year, the Great Fire of 1881, it was devastating to many of the early frame structures on here Ontario Street. But Huron Street, because of its positioning with the rail yard, really was the first street where buildings were built, because it was closest to the harbor and the railway station. It wasn't until later on that you saw things moving south on here Ontario Street and towards the current location of our town hall. There were some buildings, hotels, but they were sparsely located and definitely not as concentrated as today. Now this is a staff favorite for sure. This is a very early photograph, and the men in it are James Lindsay and Charles Cameron. So again, those only two men whose businesses were advertised in the previous slide. And from this you can see the dress of the era. Unfortunately, I don't have an exact date for this photograph, but it is a very early type of photograph. And I jokingly like to think of it as the original, best friends forever photograph in Collingwood, because these two men did seem to be connected in various ways, whether it was clubs or their commercial pursuits. James Lindsay, some of you may be familiar with a home in Collingwood that wasn't Collingwood called Balcaris. James Lindsay was the merchant who built that home, and today Collingwood Collegiate Institute is on that site, and it was quite a lovely brick building. That was in 1875, so I don't have a photograph to show you tonight, but perhaps when I'm back sometime again, I will show you. And again, here are the two businesses owned by these two men. You'll notice at the top of James Lindsay's sign there, it was also used as a Masonic building. And what we were finding is that a lot of these buildings serve many purposes. Well, the lower levels may have been commercial. A lot of clubs and organizations, churches, schools were meeting in the upper levels. Now this is a stereograph that's in the collection, and although it says in the 70s, we have another photograph that claims this is in the 60s, and this is the case with some of our photographs that we don't quite know exactly when they were taken. But the interesting thing about this photograph is that it shows the stagecoach and horse, and this was owned by Charles Cameron. And here, North American Hotel, Collingwood, Canada West, this is his advertisement from the 1866 directory. And I believe I have. So passengers by the Northern Railway at Collingwood could connect with stages to Durham, which I was quite surprised by, daily. Charles Cameron was the stage proprietor. And other common stops included Nottawa, Duntroon, Southampton, Maxwell, Fletcherton, Priceville, Durham, and again, the furthest being Durham. In the winter, there were also stages from Collingwood to Craigleith, Thornbury, Meaford, Woodford, Own Sound. I don't think I'd want to be traveling by stagecoach in the winter to those places, but for those arriving at the port of Collingwood, that was a very necessary means of transportation. Now also, in the 1866 directory, there are no less than 11 hotels listed, and I'd just like to list the names here for you now. The Algoma House, the North American Hotel, the Commercial and Ontario Hotel, the Cornboroughs Hotel, International Hotel, the Globe Hotel, Huron Hotel, Georgian Hotel, the Railway Hotel, the Royal Hotel Exchange, and Victoria House. So that's 11 hotels. As far as I can tell, the taverns are not listed, and some of the inns aren't either, because in the directory, people are listed as innkeepers, but there are no inns referenced for them. So although 11 hotels are listed, there were more than that, most definitely in 1866. I'm sure some of you will recognize this gentleman, William Watts. He was one of Collingwood's earliest settlers, and by 1867, he had quite an established boat building business. And today, actually, we discovered something quite interesting about Mr. William Watts. And we believe maybe his brother, Matthew Watts, is kind of the unsung hero of the Watts boat building business. In 1857, there's a reference to an M. Watt, so no S on the end, but the gentleman is referenced to be a fisherman and boat builder. And upon doing some further reading, we did confirm that Matthew Watts, William Watts' brother, was in the area in 1857. And it actually said that William had returned to Ireland from where he came to be married, which may explain his absence in the 1857 directory. And it also stated that in his absence, Matthew was the one running the business. And according to family history in the Watts family, whenever a child was born, William's wife, whose name was Susan, would actually return to Ireland. So a number of their children could have Ireland as their birthplace. And it really speaks to how well the family was doing to be able to afford passage to Ireland that often to get married and to have children. So we thought that that was quite an interesting story. And the Watts family did have 14 children in total. I don't believe that they've made 14 trips to Ireland, but I would feel very sorry for his wife if that was the case. But anyway, it's something to think about. And I have included a photograph of Collingwood Harbor. We have this photograph was taken by James Castor, and our records, again, there's a bit of a discrepancy on the date that it was taken. Some of our photographs say the 1960s and other, or 1860s, and others say the 1870s. But regardless, it does show the beautiful boats that the Watts family built in the background there. And that is an example of how large Collingwood's fishing fleet was. It's also interesting to note, in 1857, there are four boat builders referenced in the directory, and in 1866, there's only one, and that's the Watts family. So I don't know quite what that means, but it is quite a reduction. And further to that, in 1857, the recorded population of Collingwood was 2,000, and in 1866, it rang in just shy of 1,500. So we're looking at a 25% reduction. And again, I don't know if that was related to the repealing of that agreement with the states and why Confederation was looked forward to with such hope, but it certainly is something that we're going to be exploring at the museum this year. I actually thought I was going to do a presentation without mentioning the Trott family, and it just can't happen. So we discovered in our records that this block of property here on Here Ontario Street, actually at the southwest corner of Here Ontario and 2nd Street, where Century 21 is now, was purchased by the Trott family in 1867. So we thought, well, we couldn't argue with that, so we wanted to include it. Now the Trott family, they came to Collingwood in 1862, and they are by far, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, the longest serving business history in Collingwood. They arrived before the shipyards and they lasted after the shipyards. Indeed, the family came in 1862. And this is an example. This isn't their first storefront on the main street, but I believe it is their second. And this is where they set up until they built the beautiful three-story brick building that exists today. And actually, in the pictures we have of the 1881 fire, you can see that three-story building that is not pictured here, but exists today, going up in the background. It's quite a stunning photograph. Now this third-story building, this photograph we believe to be from about mid-1870s. We don't have an exact build date on that brick building, but it would possibly rival the Queen's Hotel or the Shipyards Medical Office as one of Collingwood's oldest brick buildings, in the absence of the Globe Hotel. Now I mentioned the Fenian raid, and I mentioned the military involvement of Collingwood, and this photograph on the bottom here was taken on the main street. You can see the Globe Hotel in the background. It was taken in 1866, and it shows the company of Collingwood soldiers that went to Niagara to ward off a Fenian attack, and the gentleman that led them on the left here was Dr. A.R. Stephen, and he's pictured at the top left as well. And he was a very early resident of Collingwood. Indeed, he came to Here Ontario Mills and constructed a home on Raglan Street that continues to exist today. Today it's known as Cozy Quarters, and I believe it's 5 Raglan Street. And it's right down by, trying to remember the name, Sunset Cove. There's a tall building there. I believe that's what it's called. It's right by the waterworks as well. And he was quite instrumental in how Collingwood would develop. He lived in Here Ontario Mills for a short time, very short time actually, and relocated to Collingwood proper and became very involved in municipal affairs and indeed the health care of Collingwood's residents. Now for those of you who attended this year's Gaslight Tour, I don't know if there's anyone out there, one of the plays was about the Fenian attack, or the almost Fenian attack of Collingwood. So while these men went to Niagara, there was a group of men who stayed in Collingwood and on home guard, and they had an agreement with the lighthouse keeper, because the lighthouse was erected in between 1855 and 1858, and it was lit the same year that Collingwood was incorporated in 1858. And if he saw the Fenian ships approaching Collingwood Harbor, because there was the belief that the Fenians may attack Collingwood to then attack Toronto from the north, that he would extinguish the light. So one night, to everyone's horror, the light went out. But they realized, and they didn't know this, but it was because of fog. But at the time, the light went out, and they rallied the women, the children, they enacted their evacuation plan, only to find out that fog had come into play, and indeed the Fenians were attacking. And when I was doing some research at the library, I came across some pretty interesting advertisements that actually I'd like to think are making a bit of a joke of this. So if you look on the left, the Fenians have not arrived, but James Lindsay's fallen winter stock is arrived daily in great quantities. So I don't know if they're making fun of each other and one another, but I think they might be. And then, latest Fenian news, great raid at the American Cheese Depot. And it's on here on Ontario Street. So I got a little bit of a kick out of that. And I think some of you did too. Now the gentleman who recounted the story of the Fenian attack was Mr. John Nettleton. And John Nettleton was also a character in a Gaslight play, but he was, that was loosely inspired by the events. And Mr. John Nettleton was one of Collingwood's early businessmen. And he also played a role in municipal government. And I did read an excerpt from his discussion about how frequently the harbor was being accessed by ships. And it's, well, it's a great connection to the States, actually. So that is a picture of Mr. Nettleton. He's credited with opening the first brick business with a dwelling above it on Huron Street. And this is actually advertising that new brick store. Now in 1867, the mayor of Collingwood was George Watson. And prior to serving as mayor, he was employed by the Northern Railway as a conductor for 11 years until he was required to quit due to ill health. He served for many years, actually. At this time, mayor was elected every year. He served between 1867 and 1871, sequentially, and he was re-elected in 1877. Now, in 1867, a municipal law came into effect, and the election of the reeve was placed in the hands of the people. Collingwood at that time had a mayor and a reeve. The councilmen were elected for 3 years, three members retiring each year. And this is the most interesting part. So once you'd elected your council, it appears you could also vote on when they retire, because it was a revolving retirement. And I thought that was quite unique. I don't think that would work today. In 1867, it's also reported that the municipality hired their first enumerator, and this was Mr. James Telfer, and he determined that in 1867, the population was 1,532 people. He was paid $10 for this. He also reported the following year, in 1868, that the population was 1,920. So that's an increase of almost 400 people in 1 year. So the year of Confederation was certainly one of change for Collingwood and one of accepting new residents that again would lead us to the Collingwood that many remember or have researched. I will say this photograph here shows the first town hall. It was also used as the first grammar school or high school, the Orange Lodge, of course. What else? The fire department. This is also a building that gives us a little bit of trouble because there seems to be a few that look quite similar that we're not quite convinced are actually the same building. According to accepted history, this building still exists. And it exists across the road from the museum on St. Paul Street. It's directly across from the cenotaph. So the next time you're by, have a look. We were looking at it today because we can see it right out of our office windows. There's something about it that doesn't seem right, but it's also been quite altered since this very early year. It was erected in 1858, the year of Collingwood's birth. One of the earliest clubs, and it's actually referenced in the 1866 directory, is the Manitou Lodge of the Masons. And the photographer, whoever wrote this description on this photograph, is brilliant because this is the most information we have about a single photograph in our collection, because it states this photograph was taken at 7:30 a.m. on August 15, 1865. If only all of our photographs were that well documented. But in here, I'm not sure if you can read the names, but these are a lot of the names that you come across over and over and over again. And all of these people were so intricately connected in their social lives and also their personal and commercial enterprises. Now the post office in Collingwood at this time was located in W.B. Hamilton's store on Huron Street. And W.B. Hamilton is pictured here. He was Collingwood's first mayor. He served as the representative for Collingwood on Nottawasaga Township Council prior to the town's incorporation, and he was appointed as mayor. So he served for 1 year, and then the residents of the town actually elected their own mayor. But he served for 22 years as Collingwood's postmaster. He was also heavily involved early on in the area. He came to Collingwood in 1854 and assumed the management of the McMaster estate, which was that John McMaster who erected the first brick building. He built a sawmill and began a lumber business. And his family also went on to play quite pivotal roles in Collingwood's history. His son actually took over from him and built on Here Ontario Street the first purpose-built post office that is now Espresso Post. So there's many examples of how these early residents and their families continue to impact and exist today in Collingwood, actually. Does anyone know where Schoolhouse Lane is? Yeah. This photograph, not taken in the year of its construction, 1858, but much later, it shows the first public school in Collingwood. It was the center ward, and it was built on Pine Street. And the original part is this section here. The brick addition was put on later, and actually was only used for about 4 years until Victoria School was built, and then they moved. Another interesting thing we came across at the museum was that you can see the bell towers boarded up. When the new Victoria School was built, they moved the bell to Victoria School. And now it currently rests at in front of the Collingwood Museum on the station grounds. So we had no idea that it was from this first building. And allegedly, this bell, it was used to alert people to fires in Collingwood, to rally the fire companies, but also as the unofficial town clock. I don't know logistically how this worked, if it really was rung on the hour, but it was an interesting piece of information that we came across. Now, the land for this property was donated by Sheriff B.W. Smith, the man who owned over 300 acres. And we'll find that he was very generous in offering his land to the public betterment of the town. Now, with this school, there were also two other schools. There was the East Ward School, which was replaced by Connaught on the east side of town. It was near the easterly end of Ontario Street, and the West Ward School, which was originally located in a two-roomed house on Oak and Fourth Streets. At this time, Collingwood boasted one of three grammar schools, which is a high school, in Simcoe County in 1867. And it had actually been in existence prior to Collingwood's incorporation in 1858. The trustees for the grammar school in 1866 included, and again you'll recognize some of these names, W.B. Hamilton, Dr. A.R. Stevens, Reverend Stephen Lett of the Anglican Church. The other grammar schools were located in Barrie and Bradford. And again, that is from the 1866 directory. Now, looking to church life in Collingwood, the only brick church that existed in 1867 was the Maple Street Methodist Church, as it was erected in 1863. And there's a photograph of it there on the left, and a photograph taken a little bit later, but really showing the life of the church in the 1870s and the congregation there. Now, public service in Collingwood originated with the Methodists in 1853 under the first resident minister, Reverend Edward Sallows, who had been sent as a missionary to the First Nations of Christian Islands. The Methodists in 1863, with their church and parsonage on lots given by Sheriff B.W. Smith, partly completed, lost both to fire. Bravely, they took up the work of reconstruction under the leadership of Reverend Charles Fish, and the same year completed the erection of the front brick section of the present Trinity United Church. Another photograph that we have, you'll notice that there's not a lot of women that I'm talking about, and it's actually pretty hard to find information on women in this area, but this is a photograph of the Methodist Pioneer Women of Collingwood, and their names are there. The last names of Bernie Trowler, which wasn't a name that's very familiar to me, Mrs. J.H. Smith, Hilborn, Lawrence, and Duncan. So we use this picture to pay tribute to the women, and I did go through the 1866 directory to see how many women were listed. And out of 263 people, there are 12 women. And their professions are listed as a fruiterer, a groceries, provisions, and fruits distributor, dressmaker, milliner, and most interestingly, a Miss R. Mulholland seemed to have owned a toy shop on Huron Terrace Street, which I thought was very interesting. Now this boat, actually, I lied. There's of course another, not brick, but stone structure that of a church that exists in 1867. And that of course is All Saints Anglican Church. And I did read that there was an addition to the church put on in this year. And I have to talk to Bruce and consult some records at the Anglican Archives to see if this is correct. But the church was built in 1858. And in the upper corner here, you'll see that this says 1868. But again, we have very similar pictures that show a similar scene in 1858. So again, another mystery. But you can see the tree stumps here. What the early pioneers of Collingwood had to deal with was quite, it would seem insurmountable, but in fact, they did succeed. Oh, went the wrong way. Now this photograph shows the first Presbyterian church in Collingwood. And it commenced in 1855 under a student named Chestnut in a partly completed frame building on Huron Terrace Street. Now this is not the Huron Terrace Street building. Indeed, this building was on Ontario Street. And we actually believe that part of it still exists. There was a fire, but part of it seems to have possibly been salvaged and attached to a home on Ontario Street. So also another mystery from 1867 that we'll be after. Now this photograph is dated 1871, and it shows the British Methodist Episcopal Church. But I wanted to include it because it speaks to a very important population in Collingwood's history, and those are the black residents of Collingwood. Now according to John Nettleton, there was quite an extensive black settlement between 6th and 7th near Walnut Street in Collingwood. And he specifically remembers that on the 1st of August, on the British Emancipation Day, a picnic and dance was held, and I quote, near the big elm trees on 3rd Street. He also states that the mayor would go and give an address. And in the evening, a lot of the residents of Collingwood would go and join in on the festivities. And he also draws specific attention to a gentleman named Pleasance Duval. And he was a barbershop owner, and he also is remembered to have an ice cream parlor and a soda parlor. And his barbershop is in here somewhere. I don't know where, unfortunately, but on the back it lists Pleasance Duval Barbershop as one of the businesses in this stretch of here, Ontario Street from 1858. So again, a very early resident of Collingwood. And he was 30 when he came here, and he came from New Orleans. And it's reported that he came for business opportunities. Another early black settler is Elijah Pyecraft. He's remembered as a noted fiddler, and he used to play on excursions on the steamers Plowboy and Francis Smith from Collingwood. He is also remembered by David Williams as being the loudest in his responses in the English church, at which he was a regular attendant. And in 1866, he's reported as the bell ringer for Collingwood, or the predecessor to today's town crier. And indeed, one would need a very loud noise, or a loud voice to be successful in that. Now that's the last specific family name that I'm going to reference. And certainly there are many more that could have been talked about this evening. Indeed, there are many businesses and industries. And I remember coming to do a presentation in 2008 for Collingwood's Festival Centennial and talking about 150 years of history in an hour. But this was almost harder because it's so specific. So there's just a few more slides, and I just wanted to address Collingwood's early fire system. And indeed, we did not have an organized fire department. We had numerous volunteer brigades, that essentially would race to the site, and if they were successful, they would be paid for their efforts. And this is an early photograph, again, a photograph that is listed with as having various dates, but in the corner here, we see the second grain terminal. So we know this is after 1870. It is not before 1870. Another early name, T. Long and brother. Thomas Long was connected with the railway and actually arrived in Toronto as a very, he arrived with nothing. He had everything he owned in a sack with him. And he gained employment on the railway, and he arrived in Ottawa and made his way to Collingwood working, and he stayed here, and he became one of the town's well-known men, largely responsible, one of the men responsible for the construction of the first dry dock in Collingwood, as well as a very generous benefactor to the town in leaving land for the public library, the federal building, and many more. But here we see the early members of one of Collingwood's fire brigades. And again, here's that very tricky building that's reported to be the first school, the first town hall, the grammar school, but its positioning doesn't seem quite right, so we're continuing to investigate this. Collingwood's police department was largely unorganized as well, and from the list of constables that are listed in Larry Cotton's Whiskey and Wickedness book, it doesn't seem like anyone was very favorable of keeping the position of chief constable very long. Indeed, a gentleman named John Rennie resigned in 1863 to be replaced by Andrew Dungeon for 2 years, who then resigned, and the next gentleman, Hal Telfer, for 1 year. And finally, in 1867, William Swain, and later William Watts. So it was really only a position someone kept for a year, 3 years max. And in Collingwood's early years, whiskey and other beverages were quite a challenge to regulate. And I would implore you, if you are interested in reading more about that history, we did bring a couple of books for sale that talk about this early period. And Whiskey and Wickedness is a very interesting read, and it's a very unique perspective on Collingwood's early history through its hotels and taverns. Because whether you were a municipal council or not, somehow you were involved with this aspect of Collingwood's history. Now, William Swain, he was one of the first. He had one of the first business houses in Collingwood, and that photograph is of his business. And the sign up here says confectioner. And earlier last year, in January, we did a exhibit at the police station. And we put together an exhibit with some of the police material we had in our collection. And one of the items was this Lead Billy or Blackjack that belonged to David Swain, who was a descendant of William Swain. So I thought that I would include that to show you today. I'll also note that Collingwood, its first jail was built in 1855, having been approved by the council because of the rowdiness and general lawlessness that seems to have ensued with the number of people coming via the railway and ship. And this is my last slide, and this is a bit of a personal slide for me. It is about the Loyal Orange Lodge, which I'm not entirely proud of, but a few summers ago, more than a few actually, I was working with the summer students, and we came across this Loyal Orange Lodge Certificate of Membership from 1867. And upon closer inspection, we determined that it was addressed to a gentleman named Conrad Common, who was my great-great-great-grandfather. So I thought that I would just leave on this note, or stop on this note, and just in thinking about all the people who would come to Collingwood from 1867 and onward, and how they would continue to shape and mold our town into what it is today, 150 years after Canada's Confederation. So I thank you. I really want to click that pointer. If you are interested in seeing what we're up to at the museum, we have a pretty active Facebook page. It's just facebook.com/Collingwood Museum. Again, I did bring a couple of books if anyone's interested in having a look at the front that are for sale. And if anybody has any questions, we have a few minutes, I think. I will try my best. I also brought, in case anyone's interested, a copy of the 1866 section of the Simcoe County Directory for Collingwood, if anyone wants to have a look. And I also have the 1857 directory as well, in case anyone wants to look up your family names to see if anyone was here. Yeah?
Do you happen to know where the jail was built?
So there's a, not the first one, but there's a photograph of George Collins, who was the lighthouse keeper, on a horse. And there's a small brick structure in the back, and it references Collingwood's jail. There's more than one brick structure, though, and I don't know which one it's indicating, but we have yet to come across that on a map. Yeah, no, that's a good question. Any other questions? Yeah. Yeah?
I was just going to mention, and sorry for interjecting here, there's a connection between Collingwood's agent and the town of Collingwood. They both incorporated within a year of each other.
Yes.
And you mentioned David Williams.
Yes.
And his brother, Williams, was the principal of Collingwood's agent as well.
Yeah, it was actually his father. William Williams was David Williams' father, and he came to Collingwood and was principal of the grammar school, and he was the principal that was there when the Collingwood Collegiate of 1874 was constructed. You're absolutely right.
Thanks.
Absolutely.
Thanks for correcting me.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You're welcome. Thank you. Yep.
And I was going to mention one other thing. You mentioned fires.
Yes.
There was a fire back in 1933 mm-hmm. that burnt the roof and the tower off the station. And so the committee that headed up the resurrection of that building were able to secure the plans from the archives in Ottawa.
Yes.
And so what you see there now is the exact replica of what was there prior to the fire in 1933. So people growing up in Collingwood in the 30s and 40s never did see the tower on that building.
That's right. The tower wasn't seen again until the current station was reconstructed in 1998.
And they just band-aided it back in the 30s because there wasn't very much money, so that's all they could do.
Yeah, no, thank you. I meant to mention that. The station that we have today is actually it very much resembles Collingwood Second Train Station, which replaced that tunnel station that sat along Huron Street. Yeah. Yes?
There's a group on Facebook that if you grew up in Collingwood, they talk about where there's a school on Third Street and somewhere, I think it was around Oak or Walnut, and they found
mm-hmm.
There's
inkwells
in the person's backyard and that. Have you ever found another school besides the ones that you've been talking about?
Yeah, one of the schools was at Oak and Forth.
Cedar. Okay.
That was the West Ward, but there was also one. Lindsay's been doing a lot of research, and she's been studying at Cedar and Forth as well.
Cedar and Forth, okay.
Yeah. I have no idea. And the pictures that we have are the history of Collingwood that we have is largely from what people bring to the museum and what survived. So in a lot of cases, we have a lot of gaps. And
where was the first cemetery, and where would most of these older stones be located?
The cemetery on Raglan Street. That is for the Anglican Church and the Catholic Church. Do you know which year that was established, Bruce?
No, I can't recall.
I did read that there was a cemetery also with St. Timothy on the east side in the Huron Ontario Mills settlement.
Has that been proved?
I have yet to prove it, but I read it.
Okay, yes, I read it too.
Yeah. But the Anglican, the cemetery on Raglan, that area was the original settlement within the area. So that would be where a lot of the oldest would be. You're welcome. Well, thank you very much, everyone. Thanks for coming out on a winter's evening.
Wonderful trip back to the past and opening a door for everybody.
Thanks, Patrick.